Although Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol is a relatively new American Christmas tradition, the message contained in this 19th century English classic is timeless. Since Christmas Eve 1984, WQRC has been privileged to bring you a special radio adaptation of this novel, narrated by the great-granddaughter of Charles Dickens, Monica Dickens. Monica was born in London May 10, 1915, and she distinguished herself as one of post-war Britain's most popular literary voices. She was the author of over 50 books, many of them written right here on Cape Cod. In 1951, she married Commander Roy Stratton of the U.S. Navy, and after living in Washington for a few years, the couple moved to Cape Cod, an area the commander had fallen in love with after his first visit in 1946. And for over 35 years, Monica enriched our life here on Cape Cod by, among other things, establishing a branch of the international suicide prevention group, the Samaritans, in Falmouth in 1974. I first met Monica when she asked for some help in publicizing the new Samaritans branch in Falmouth, and like thousands who had the privilege of knowing her, I was struck at once by her physical and intellectual energy and her formidable verbal and writing abilities. She left a large vacuum here on the Cape when she moved back to England after Roy's death in 1985. And when Monica died on Christmas Day 1992 in Reading, England, millions of people felt a great loss. In 1984, knowing Monica would bring a great insight into the project, I asked her to do a radio narration of the carol. As a child, she listened to her grandfather, Henry, narrate this each Christmas time, and he had learned the story from his father, the author. Well, Monica consented to my request, and so we're now honored again this Christmas Eve to present the results. Before the narration, I asked Monica in 1984 to give us some background into how her great-grandfather, Charles Dickens, came to write A Christmas Carol.
It's a curious story. As everybody knows, the Christmas Carol is against greed and money-making and thought about material things, and money doesn't matter, but love and the spirit do. And in actual fact, poor Charles Dickens wrote the Christmas Carol because he badly needed money, and he wrote it as a commercial project. He was loaded down with debts. It's hard to believe now that a best-selling author could be so poor, but he had had some bad luck with his publishers, and his family were always borrowing from him. His mother and father were always trying to touch him for a loan. His children, not my grandfather, I hasten to add, were rather profligate. And he was on his beam ends, and he thought to himself that he must make some money quickly. This was in October. So he thought, I'll write a Christmas story. It'll be published. People will buy it for Christmas, and I will make enough money to pay my bills. This was October of the same year in which the carol was published, which shows you how far we've progressed. It now takes at least a year to get a book published after you finish it. But he wrote the thing. It was published within the space of about 2 months. And of course, although it started as a purely commercial thing, as he got into the writing, he got so caught up in it. And as he described himself, he finished in a white heat of enthusiasm that got him walking the streets at night when many and many sober folks had gone to bed, he said. He fell in love with it. He forgot about needing to make money, and he just was caught up in the story. And his readers were caught up too. It was an instant success. Ironically, he didn't make much money out of it because, having quarreled with his publishers, he insisted on publishing it at his own expense. He had three color illustrations, which was very extravagant in those days, gold leaf on the edges of the pages. And he ended up, I think, with something like £1,000. I mean, God knows how many millions of dollars and pounds the carol has earned since.
Did your grandfather ever mention that he had listened to Charles Dickens read portions of this?
Absolutely. Dickens used to read, I mean, what I'm reading today is, of course, a cut version of the carol, which is quite a long story. All the family always sat, and Dickens read the Christmas Carol to them when they were children. And then when we were children, my grandfather would always read the carol to all of us. And so I got the feeling that since he had listened to his own father reciting, he was giving us a pretty good imitation of Charles Dickens. And when I saw, you know, Emlyn Williams does these readings from Dickens, and when I saw Emlyn Williams doing the carol, he looked and sounded just like my grandfather. So I think he was pretty spot on.
What do you consider the secret of it, the ingredient that not only made it an instant hit in Charles Dickens' homeland of England, but that it has now been adopted by Americans, and I don't think anyone's Christmas is complete without watching it on television or hearing it, maybe having you recite it as you have over the years here at QRC, but what do you think are the secret ingredients of A Christmas Carol that makes it such a universally loved story?
Maybe it's something slightly different to everyone. The story, when you analyze it, is very simple, perhaps quite corny, a very obvious sentiment. But I think why I like it and why I enjoy reading it, because it gives one an opportunity to indulge in sentiment, plain old-fashioned sentiment. I think that's why people like it. They can laugh and cry. The words are so marvelous. The Dickens's choice of words are just unbelievable. I've always been convinced that if Dickens had lived later in time, he would have written for the movies and television, because his choice of words is so visual. When you're reading it or listening to it, it's creating pictures that run through your head, which is what he did with words. If you analyze his choice of adjectives, he never picks the easy, ordinary, flat, commonplace adjective. It's always something that with color and smell and feel to it.
And I think, too, he has captured so well the essence of what Christmas signifies to so many people, the redemptive spirit that exists at this time of year. It's a man who is truly able to redeem his past life, and we all like to think we can do that.
That's right. And Dickens says that Scrooge continued live the spirit of Christmas all year round. I hope he did. How many of us, enjoying our family Christmas and loving everybody, vow, oh, I'm going to be like this always now. And how many of us flop the day after Christmas Day back into our old ways?
In just a moment, Monica Dickens narrates her great-grandfather's classic story, Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. And now Monica Dickens narrates the conclusion of Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol.
"Spectre," said Scrooge, "tell me what man that was whom we saw lying dead." "A churchyard." "Here then the wretched man whose name he had now to learn lay underneath the ground. The spirit stood among the graves and pointed down to one. Scrooge crept towards it, trembling as he went, and following the finger, read upon the stone of the neglected grave his own name, Ebenezer Scrooge. "Am I that man who lay upon the bed?" he cried upon his knees. The finger pointed from the grave to him and back again. "No, spirit, oh no, no." The finger was still there. "Spirit," he cried, tight clutching at its robe, "hear me. I am not the man I was. I will honor Christmas in my heart and try to keep it all the year. I will not shut out the lessons that the spirits teach. Oh, tell me that I may sponge away the writing on this stone." Holding up his hands in a last prayer to have his fate reversed, he saw an alteration in the phantom's hood and dress. It shrunk, collapsed, and dwindled down into a bedpost. Yes, and the bedpost was his own. The bed was his own, the room was his own. Best and happiest of all, the time before him was his own to make amends in. Running to the window, he opened it and put out his head. No fog, no mist, clear, bright, jovial, stirring cold. Gold and sunlight, heavenly sky, sweet fresh air, merry bells. Oh, glorious, glorious. "What's today?" cried Scrooge, calling downward to a boy in Sunday clothes. "Today," replied the boy, "why, Christmas Day."
"Of all the days in all the year that I'm familiar with, there's only one that's rarely fun.
December 20th.
Ask anyone, call Robinson, or Brown, or Jones, or Smith. their favorite day, and they will say,
"This Christmas Day," said Scrooge, "I haven't missed it. Do you know the poulterers in the next street but one at the corner? Do you know whether they've sold the prize turkey that was hanging up there?"
"What?"
"The one as big as me? It's hanging there now." "Is it?" said Scrooge. "Go and buy it. Go and buy it and tell them to bring it here." "I'll send it to Bob Cratchit," whispered Scrooge, rubbing his hands and splitting with a laugh. "He shan't know who sends it. It's twice the size of Tiny Tim." The chuckle with which he said this, and the chuckle with which he paid for the turkey, and the chuckle with which he paid for the cab, and the chuckle with which he recompensed the boy, were only to be exceeded by the chuckle with which he sat down breathless in his chair again and chuckled till he cried.
"December the 25th, my dears, December the 25th, the dearest day in all the year. December the 25th, my dears, December the 25th, my dears, December the 25th, my dears, December the 25th."
He dressed himself, all in his best, and got out into the streets. The people were by this time pouring forth, and walking with his hands behind him, Scrooge looked so irresistibly pleasant that three or four good-humoured fellows said, "Good morning, sir. A Merry Christmas to you." And Scrooge said often afterwards that of all the blithe sounds he had ever heard, those were the blithest in his ears. Church. In the afternoon, he turned his steps towards his nephew's house and announced himself gaily for dinner. Wonderful party, wonderful games, wonderful unanimity, wonderful happiness. He was early at the office next morning. Oh, he was early there. If he could only be there first and catch Bob Cratchit coming late. And he did it. Yes, he did. Bob was full 18 minutes and a half behind his time. "Hello," growled Scrooge in his accustomed voice, as near as he could feign it. "What do you mean by coming here at this time of day?"
It's only once a year, sir," pleaded Bob. "It shall not be repeated. I was making rather merry yesterday, sir."
"Now I'll tell you what, my friend," said Scrooge. "I'm not going to stand this sort of thing any longer. And therefore," he continued, leaping from his stool, "and therefore I am about to raise your salary. A Merry Christmas, Bob. A merrier Christmas, Bob, my good fellow, than I have given you for many a year."
"Sing a song of gladness and cheer, sing of gladness and cheer, for the time of Christmas is here, is here. Look around and see, look around and see, what a world of wonder this world can be. Sing a Christmas carol, sing a Christmas carol, sing a Christmas carol, sing a Christmas carol.
Scrooge was better than his word. He did all he promised and infinitely more. And to Tiny Tim, who did not die, he was a second father.
He became as good a friend, as good a master, and as good a man as the good old city knew, or any other good old city, town, or borough in the good old world. And it was always said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas well, if any man alive possessed the knowledge. May that be truly said of us and of all of us. And so, as Tiny Tim observed, God bless us, everyone. Was dead to begin with. There is no doubt whatever about that. Old Marley was as dead as a doornail. Scrooge never painted out Old Marley's name. There it stood years afterwards above the warehouse door. Scrooge and Marley. Oh, but he was a tight-fisted hand at the grindstone, Scrooge. A squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. The cold within him froze his old features, nipped his pointed nose, shriveled his cheeks, stiffened his gait, made his eyes red, his thin lips blue, and spoke out shrewdly in his grating voice. Once upon a time, of all the good days in the year on Christmas Eve, old Scrooge sat busy in his counting house. It was cold, bleak, biting weather, foggy withal, and he could hear the people in the court outside go wheezing up and down, beating their hands upon their breasts and stamping their feet upon the pavement stones to warm them. The door of Scrooge's counting house was open, that he might keep his eye upon his clerk, who in a dismal little cell beyond, a sort of tank, was copying letters. Scrooge had a very small fire, but the clerk's fire was so very much smaller that it looked like one coal. But he couldn't replenish it, for Scrooge kept the coal box in his own room. And so surely as the clerk came in with the shovel, the master predicted that it would be necessary for them to part. Wherefore the clerk put on his white comforter and tried to warm himself at the candle, in which effort, not being a man of strong imagination, he failed. "A Merry Christmas, Uncle! God save you!" cried a cheerful voice. It was the voice of Scrooge's nephew, who came upon him so quickly that this was the first inclination he had of his approach. "Bah," said Scrooge, "humbug." He had so heated himself with rapid walking in the fog and frost, this nephew of Scrooge's, that he was all in a glow. His face was ruddy and handsome, his eyes sparkled, and his breath smoked again. "Christmas a humbug, Uncle," said Scrooge's nephew. "You don't mean that, I'm sure." "I do," said Scrooge. "Merry Christmas. What right have you to be merry? What reason have you to be merry? You're poor enough." "Come then," returned the nephew gaily. "What right have you to be dismal? What reason have you to be morose? You're rich enough." Scrooge, having no better answer ready on the spur of the moment, said "Bah!" again, and followed it up with "Humbug." "Don't be cross, Uncle," said the nephew. "What else can I be," returned the uncle, "when I live in such a world of fools as this? Merry Christmas! Out upon Merry Christmas!" "If I could work my will," said Scrooge indignantly, "every idiot who goes about with Merry Christmas on his lips should be boiled with his own pudding and buried with a stake of holly through his heart."
"Humbug! Poppycock! Balderdash! Bah! I hate people! I hate people! People are despicable creatures, loathsome, inexplicable creatures, good for nothing, kickable creatures. I hate people!"
"I am sorry with all my heart," the nephew said, "to find you so resolute. But I'll keep my Christmas humor to the last, so a Merry Christmas, Uncle." "Good afternoon," said Scrooge, "and a Happy New Year." "Good afternoon," said Scrooge. His nephew left the room without an angry word, notwithstanding. He stopped at the outer door to bestow the greetings of the season on the clerk, who, cold as he was warmer than Scrooge, for he returned them cordially. "Ha, and there's another fellow," muttered Scrooge, who overheard him. "My clerk, with 15 shillings a week and a wife and family, talking about a Merry Christmas. I'll retire to Bedlam."
"Humbug! Poppycock! Balderdash! Bah! I hate people! I hate people!"
This lunatic, in letting Scrooge's nephew out, had let two other people in. They were portly gentlemen, pleasant to behold, and now stood with their hats off in Scrooge's office. "At this festive season of the year, Mr. Scrooge," said one of the gentlemen, taking up a pen, "it is more than usually desirable that we should make some slight provision for the poor and destitute, who suffer greatly at the present time. What shall I put you down for? Many thousands are in want of common necessities. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comfort, sir." "Are there no prisons?" asked Scrooge. "Plenty of prisons," said the gentleman. "And the union workhouses?" demanded Scrooge. "Are they still in operation?" "They are, still," returned the gentleman. "I wish I could say that they were not." "Then those who are badly off must go there," said Scrooge. "Many can't go there, and many would rather die." "Ha, if they would rather die," said Scrooge, "they had better do it, and decrease the surplus population."
"I hate people, I loathe people, I despise and abominate people. Life is full of cretinous wretches, earning what their sweat and its fetches, empty minds whose pettiness stretches further than I can see. Little wonder I hate people, and I don't care if they hate me."
After the gentleman left, with no donation for the poor, Scrooge locked up and went home. He closed his door and locked himself in, put on his dressing gown and slippers and his nightcap, and sat down before the fire to take his gruel. As he threw his head back in the chair, his glance happened to rest upon a bell that hung in the room. It was with great astonishment and with a strange, inexplicable dread, that as he looked, he saw this bell begin to swing. It swung so softly that it seemed scarcely to make a sound. But soon it rang out loudly, and so did every bell in the house. The bells ceased as they had begun. They were succeeded by a clanking noise deep down below, as if some person were dragging a heavy chain over the casks in the wine merchant's cellar. The cellar door flew open with a booming sound, and then he heard the noise much louder on the floors below, then coming up the stairs, then coming straight towards his door. "Nah, it's humbug still," said Scrooge. "I won't believe it." His colour changed, though, when without a pause it came on through the heavy door and passed into the room before his eyes. Upon its coming in, the dying flame leapt up as though it cried, "I know him, Marley's ghost," and fell again. The same face, the very same, Marley. In his pigtail, usual waistcoat, tights and boots. The chain he drew was clasped about his middle. It was made of cash boxes, keys, padlocks, ledgers, deeds and heavy purses wrought in steel. His body was transparent, so that Scrooge, observing him and looking through his waistcoat, could see the two buttons on his coat behind. "How now," said Scrooge, caustic and cold as ever. "What do you want with me?" "Much." Marley's voice, no doubt about that. "Who are you?" "Ask me who I was." "Who were you then?" said Scrooge, raising his voice. "In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley." Can you sit down?" asked Scrooge, looking doubtfully at him. "I can." "Do it, then." "You don't believe in me," observed the ghost. "I don't," said Scrooge. "Why do you doubt your senses?" "Because," said Scrooge, "a little thing affects them. A slight disorder of the stomach makes them cheat. You may be an undigested bit of beef, a blot of mustard, a crumb of cheese, a fragment of an underdone potato. There's more of gravy than of grave about you, whatever you are." "Humbug, I tell you, humbug." At this, the spirit raised a frightful cry and shook its chain with such a dismal and appalling noise that Scrooge held on tight to his chair to save himself from falling in a swoon. But how much greater was his horror when the phantom, taking off the bandage round its head as if it were too warm to wear indoors, its lower jaw dropped down upon his breast. Scrooge fell upon his knees and clasped his hands before his face. "Mercy," he said, "dreadful apparition, why do you trouble me?" "Man of the worldly mind," replied the ghost, "do you believe in me or not?" "I do," said Scrooge, "I must. But why do spirits walk the earth? And why do they come to me?"
"Tell me more, Marley, but speak comfort to me."
"I have none to give."
"But you were always a good man of business."
"Mankind should be our business, Ebenezer. But we seldom attend to it, as you shall see. See the phantoms filling the sky around you. They astound you, I can tell. These inhabitants of hell. Poor wretches whom the hand of heaven ignores. Beware, 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 lest their dreadful fate be
Scrooge was very much dismayed to hear the spectre going on at this rate, and began to quake exceedingly. "Hear me," cried the ghost, "my time is nearly gone. I am here tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping my fate." "You were always a good friend to me," said Scrooge. "Thank ye. You will be haunted by three spirits." I think I'd rather not," said Scrooge. "Without their visits," said the ghost, "you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first tomorrow when the bell tolls one. Expect the second on the next night at the same hour. The third upon the next night when the last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more, and look that, for your own sake, you remember what has passed between us." The ghost vanished. Scrooge went to bed without undressing and fell asleep. He woke to the church bell chiming the hour of one. Light flashed up in the room upon the instant, and the curtains of his bed were drawn. The curtains of his bed were drawn aside, I tell you, by a hand. Not the curtains at his feet, nor the curtains at the back, but those to which his face was addressed. The curtains of his bed were drawn aside, and Scrooge, starting up into a half-recumbent attitude, found himself face to face with the unearthly visitor who drew them. It was a strange figure, like a child, yet not so like a child as like an old man. Its hair, which hung about its neck and down its back, was white, as if with age, and yet the face had not a wrinkle in it, and the tenderest bloom was on the skin. "Are you the spirit, sir, whose coming was foretold to me?" asked Scrooge. "I am." The voice was soft and gentle, singularly low, as if instead of being so close beside him, it were at a distance. "Who and what are you?" Scrooge demanded. "I am the ghost of Christmas past." "Long past?" inquired Scrooge. "No, your past." It put out its strong hand as it spoke and clasped him gently by the arm. "Rise and walk with me." As the words were spoken, they passed through the wall and stood upon an open country road with fields on either hand. The city had entirely vanished. The darkness and the mist had vanished with it, for it was clear, cold winter day with snow upon the ground. "Good heavens," said Scrooge, clasping his hands together as he looked about him. "I was bred in this place. I was a boy here." "Your lip is trembling," said the ghost, "and what is that upon your cheek?" Scrooge muttered with an unusual catching in his voice that it was a pimple, and begged the ghost to lead him where he would. They walked along the road, Scrooge recognizing every gate and post and tree. Some shaggy ponies now were seen trotting towards them with boys upon their backs, who called to other boys in country gigs and carts driven by farmers. All these boys were in great spirits and shouted to each other until the broad fields were so full of merry music that the crisp air laughed to hear it. Scrooge knew and named them every one. Why was he rejoiced beyond all bounds to see them? Why did his cold eye glisten and his heart leap up as they went past? Why was he filled with gladness when he heard them give each other Merry Christmas as they parted at crossroads and byways for their several homes? What was Merry Christmas to Scrooge? Ah, out upon Merry Christmas. What good had it ever done to him? The school is not quite deserted, said the ghost. A solitary child, neglected by his friends, is left there still. Scrooge said he knew it, and he sobbed. They left the high road by a well-remembered lane and soon approached a mansion of dull red brick. They went, the ghost and Scrooge, to a door at the back of the house. It opened before them and disclosed a long, bare, melancholy room, made barer still by lines of plain deal forms and desks. At one of these, a lonely boy was reading near a feeble fire. And Scrooge sat down upon a form and wept to see his poor forgotten self as he had used to be. I wish, he muttered, putting his hand in his pocket and looking about him after drying his eyes with his cuff, but it's too late now. What is the matter? Asked the spirit. Oh, nothing, said Scrooge, nothing. There was a boy singing a Christmas carol at my door last night. I should have liked to have given him something. That's all. Although they had but at that moment left the school behind them, they were now in the busy thoroughfare of a city. It was made plain enough by the dressing of the shops that here, too, it was Christmas time again. But it was evening, and the streets were lighted up. The ghost stopped at a certain warehouse door and asked Scrooge if he knew it. Know it, said Scrooge. Was I apprenticed here? They went in, at sight of an old gentleman in a Welsh wig, sitting behind such a high desk that if he had been 2 inches taller, he must have knocked his head against the ceiling. Scrooge cried out in great excitement, Why, it's old Fezziwig! Bless his heart, it's Fezziwig, alive again! Old Fezziwig laid down his pen and called out in a comfortable, oily, rich, fat, jovial voice, Yo-ho there, Ebenezer, Dick! Scrooge's former self, now grown a young man, came briskly in, accompanied by his fellow apprentice. Yo-ho, my boys, said Fezziwig. No more work tonight. Christmas Eve, Dick. Christmas, Ebenezer. Clear away, me lads, and let's have lots of rum here. Hilly-ho, Dick. Chirrup, Ebenezer. It was done in a minute. And in came a fiddle with a music book and went up to a lofty desk and made an orchestra of it, and tuned like 50 stomachaches. In came Mrs. Fezziwig, one vast, substantial smile. In came the 3 Miss Fezziwigs, beaming and lovable. In came the 6 young followers, whose hearts they broke. In came all the young men and women employed in the business. In came the housemaid with her cousin the baker. In came the cook with her brother's particular friend the milkman. And away they all went, 20 couples at once, hands half round and back again the other way, down the middle and up again, round and round in various stages of affectionate grouping. There were more dances, and there were forfeits, and more dances, and there was cake, and there was negus, and there was a great piece of cold roast, and there was a great piece of cold boiled, and there were mince pies and plenty of beer. When the clock struck 11, this domestic ball broke up. Mr. and Mrs. Fezziwig took their stations, one on either side the door, and shaking hands with every person individually as he or she went out, wished him or her a Merry Christmas. Thus the cheerful voices died away, and the lads were left to their beds, which were under a counter in the back shop. During the whole of this time, Scrooge had acted like a man out of his wits. His heart and soul were in the scene and with his former self. A small matter, said the ghost, to make these silly folk so full of gratitude. The spirit signed to Scrooge to listen to the 2 apprentices who were pouring out their hearts in praise of Fezziwig, and when he had done so, said, Why, is it not? He has spent but a few pounds of your mortal money, 3 or 4 perhaps. Is that so much that he deserves this praise? It isn't that, said Scrooge. heated by the remark and speaking unconsciously like his former self. It isn't that spirit. The happiness he gives is quite as great as if it cost a fortune. He felt the spirit's glance and stopped. "What is the matter?" asked the ghost. "Well, nothing particular," said Scrooge. I should like to be able to say a word or two to my clerk just now. That's all." He was conscious of being exhausted and overcome by an irresistible drowsiness, and further, of being in his own bedroom, and had barely time to reel to bed before he sank into a heavy sleep. Waking in the middle of a prodigiously loud snore and sitting up in bed to get his thoughts together, Scrooge had no occasion to be told that the bell was again upon the stroke of one. A light came under the door of the other room, and a strange voice called him by his name. The room had undergone a surprising transformation. The walls and ceiling were so hung with living green that it looked a perfect grove, from every part of which bright, gleaming berries glistened. Heaped up on the floor to form a kind of throne were turkeys, geese, game, poultry, brawn, great joints of meat, sucking pigs, long wreaths of sausages, mince pies, plum puddings, barrels of oysters, and seething bowls of punch. In easy state upon this couch there sat a jolly giant, glorious to see, who bore a glowing torch in shape not unlike Plenty's horn. "Come in," exclaimed the ghost. "Come in and know me better, man." Scrooge entered timidly and hung his head before this spirit. "I am the ghost of Christmas present," said the spirit. "Look upon me." "Spirit," said Scrooge submissively, "conduct me where you will. I went forth last night on compulsion, and I learned a lesson which is working now. Touch my robe." Scrooge did as he was told and held it fast. Holly, mistletoe, red berries, ivy, turkeys, geese, game, poultry, brawn, meat, pigs, sausages, oysters, all vanished instantly. So did the room, the fire, the ruddy glow, the hour of night, and they stood in the city streets on Christmas morning. The poulterers' shops were still half open, and the fruiterers were radiant in their glory. There were great round pot-bellied baskets of chestnuts shaped like the waistcoats of jolly old gentlemen, lolling at the doors and tumbling out into the street in their apoplectic opulence. There were ruddy, brown-faced, broad-girthed Spanish onions, shining in the fatness of their growth like Spanish friars, and winking from their shelves in wanton slyness at the girls as they went by and glanced demurely at the hung-up mistletoe. Everything was good to eat and in its Christmas dress. The customers were all so hurried and so eager in the hopeful promise of the day that they tumbled up against each other at the door, crashing their wicker baskets wildly. When there were angry words between people who had jostled each other, the spirit shed a few drops of incense on them from his torch, and their good humor was restored directly. For, they said, it was a shame to quarrel upon Christmas Day. And so it was. God love it, so it was. The spirit took Scrooge to the poor dwelling of his clerk, Bob Cratchit. Then up rose Mrs. Cratchit, brave in ribbons, which are cheap and make a goodly show for sixpence, and she laid the cloth, assisted by Belinda Cratchit, second of her daughters, also brave in ribbons, while Master Peter Cratchit plunged a fork into the saucepan of potatoes. And now two smaller Cratchits, boy and girl, came running in, and Martha Cratchit came, late from her work. And in came little Bob, the father, his threadbare clothes darned up and brushed to look seasonable, and Tiny Tim upon his shoulder. Alas for Tiny Tim, he bore a little crutch and had his limbs supported by an iron frame. "And how did little Tim behave?" asked Mrs. Cratchit. "As good as gold," said Bob, "and better. Somehow he gets thoughtful sitting by himself so much and thinks the strangest things you ever heard. He told me, coming home, that he hoped the people saw him in the church because he was a cripple, and it might be pleasant to them to remember upon Christmas Day who made lame beggars walk and blind men see." Then Bob compounded some hot mixture in a jug with gin and lemons, and Master Peter and the two young Cratchits went to fetch the goose, with which they soon returned in high procession. The dishes were set on and grace was said. It was succeeded by a breathless pause as Mrs. Cratchit, looking slowly all along the carving knife, prepared to plunge it in the breast. But when she did, and when the long-expected gush of stuffing issued forth, the murmur of delight arose all round the board, and even Tiny Tim, excited by the two young Cratchits, beat on the table with the handle of his knife and feebly cried, "Hurrah!" There never was such a goose. Bob said he didn't believe there ever was such a goose cooked. Its tenderness and flavor, size and cheapness, were the themes of universal admiration. Then Mrs. Cratchit entered, flushed but smiling proudly, with the pudding, like a speckled cannonball, so hard and firm, blazing in half a quartern of ignited brandy, and bedight with Christmas holly stuck into the top. "Oh, a wonderful pudding," Bob Cratchit said, and calmly too, that he regarded it as the greatest success achieved by Mrs. Cratchit since their marriage. Then all the Cratchit family drew round the hearth, and at Bob Cratchit's elbow stood the family display of glass, two tumblers and a custard cup without a handle. These held the hot stuff from the jug. And Bob proposed, "A Merry Christmas to us all, my dears. God bless us," which all the family re-echoed. "God bless us, everyone," said Tiny Tim, the last of all. "Spirits," said Scrooge, with an interest he had never felt before. "Tell me if Tiny Tim will live." "I see a vacant seat," replied the ghost, "in the poor chimney corner, and a crutch without an owner, carefully preserved. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die." "What then? If he be like to die, he had better do it and decrease the surplus population." Scrooge hung his head to hear his own words quoted by the spirit, and was overcome with penitence and grief. The spectre showed Scrooge many other happy Christmas scenes, including the delightful party at his nephew's house, which Scrooge had refused with a bar humbug. On the stroke of midnight it faded, and Scrooge beheld a solemn phantom, draped and hooded, coming like a mist along the ground towards him. "Ghost of the future," cried the terrified and remorseful Scrooge. "Lead on." The phantom took him to the city, where businessmen were cynically discussing the unmourned death of some despised man. Then to a junk shop in a filthy alley, where the scavengers of death had come to sell the corpse's stolen possessions and talk about him obscenely, in hate for what he was and greed for what he had. "Spirit," said Scrooge, shuddering, "I see, I see. The case of this unhappy man might be my own." "Oh, merciful heaven, what is this?" He recoiled in terror, for the scene had changed, and now he almost touched a bed on which, beneath a ragged sheet, there lay a something covered up, which, though it was dumb, announced itself in awful language. A pale light fell straight upon the bed, and on it, plundered and bereft, unwatched, unwept, uncared for, was the body of this man. "Let me see some tenderness connected with a death," said Scrooge, "or that dark chamber which we left just now will be forever present to me." They went back to the Cratchits' home, where the mother and children were greeting Bob. She hurried out to meet him, and little Bob in his comforter, he had need of it, poor fellow, came in. Then the two young Cratchits got upon his knees and laid each child a little cheek against his face, as if they said, "Don't mind it, father, don't be grieved." "You went today, then, Robert?" said his wife. "Yes, my dear," returned Bob. "I wish you could have gone. It would have done you good to see how green a place it is. But you'll see it often. I promised him that I would walk there on a Sunday." "My little, little child," cried Bob. "My little child." He left the room and went upstairs into the room above, which was lighted cheerfully and hung with Christmas. There was a chair set close beside the child, and there were signs of someone having been there lately. Poor Bob sat down in it, and when he had thought a little and composed himself, he kissed the little face. He was reconciled to what had happened and went down again quite happy.
In just one moment, Monica Dickens concludes the narration of Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol.